It's the Hot Rock Podcast. Steve Garland with you. Now, before we start this show, I want you to know that finally, after all these years, one of my favorite bands, Night Ranger, is coming to my neck of the woods Sunday, September 3rd at the venue in Thunder Valley. That's in Lincoln, California, not far from me. And I know we have a worldwide audience. I know they've been on tour all year, so I thought this would be a perfect occasion to press the hotline button and say hi to Night Ranger's own Brad Gillis. How's it going, Brad?
Hey, Steve. It's going fine, my friend. Jeez, I've known you forever, man.
I know.
30 years or something?
Yeah. Well, it was shortly after the band got together that we started promoting your stuff in San Francisco radio. That was 83. I did see you with the Lucky Lion probably around 79 or 80.
Wow, those were the days, boy. I tell you, man. I had to keep my chops up. So, you know, we ended up playing the Bay Area, all these great venues, and the Lucky Lion was one of them.
Absolutely. Now the venues are worldwide. You guys have been everywhere this past year. So tell me how the tour has been going so far, and where you've been this year.
Well, I tell you, you know, we ended up last year by going to Japan. We always end up, we've probably been over there about 17, 18 times. Whenever we release a record, and we just put out ATVPO, our last record, you know, about a year and a half or so ago. So we did Japan and had three sold out shows in Tokyo and then one in Osaka. That was great. Starting this year all over the map, and we just finished a great, couple month tour with Bret Michaels and the Jefferson Starship and Sugar Ray popped in for a couple songs, and Steve O'Jerry, of course, who sang with Journey for about 10 years, came up and did some Journey tunes. So it was awesome, man. It was, you know, all over the country and just a blast. And now we're, you know, back to kind of doing our shows and building up with other people here and there. So that's where we're at, man.
Awesome. Well, the band's 40th anniversary was last year, and I know we talked right after ATBPO came out. So you had this huge 40th anniversary tour, and then this year is the 40th anniversary of the band's second album, Midnight Madness. It seems insane that it's been that long, but it seems like yesterday all at once.
Well, I tell you, it doesn't seem like yesterday for me, because since then I've done about 3,500 shows. So and you know, I tell people I travel for a living and play in a band on the side. Just seems like all I do is travel. And this summer doing this bus tour, I gotta tell you, you know, I'm not into buses anymore. Back in the 80s it was fun, but it's all great. I'm not complaining. I got a couple days off at home, and then things were slowing down a little bit, and we're kind of getting back to doing the weekend warrior thing. That's where we head out and, you know, do a couple shows in the weekend, and we're all home during the week. So I like that because I got other projects going on.
Oh, always. And speaking of other projects, I understand there's a couple of big things coming up for Night Ranger.
Well, I got to tell you, I got to write this new one off my bucket list because we went and recorded with the Cleveland's own Contemporary Youth Orchestra a while back. These kids were between, I think, 14 and 16, something like that. There was about 90 of them in the orchestra. And we did a whole show recording us together. And that's going to be released, I think, in the middle of October. So that's, you know, all these other big bands have done this and in the past. So this is our turn to go in and release us doing one. So it was quite a blast, you know, and just, you know, rehearsing with these kids and the finished product turned out great. The video's great. And just looking forward to that being released. So that's the latest, greatest, newest release going to be out in the middle of October.
Wow. So what was that like playing with a symphony orchestra? I saw, you know, The Who have played with symphonies for like, I don't know, since Tommy. But to hear, you know, You Can Still Rock in America and Don't Tell Me You Love Me with a symphony orchestra. When you were on stage, how did that feel to you?
Well, I had a hard time not turning around and watching them because it was just so awesome. But, it scratched that one off my bucket list. Always, all these other bands that have done it, you know, and it is great to have the opportunity to do it. And the kids loved it. And I think we turned on a whole new generation of fans by having these kids join us to do this show. So we played all of our, you know, all of our big hits and then some, and this DVD will be released here in a month and a half or two. So, and you know, then we're back on the road touring and all over the map to the end of the year. And it's just great to still be doing this 40 years later, Steve.
There are so many bands who have burned out due to either infights or drugs or just no interest from the fans. But I've seen enough of your shows over the years to know that the energy is always there. You know, Jack's vocals, Kelly's vocals are just as good, if not even better now than they used to be. But for you, how would you say the live shows in particular have evolved over the years?
Well, it's always a new energy with the, you know, different players we have that are, you know, going on second guitarists and keyboards. Now we've had Kerry Kelly, I shouldn't say second guitar because he plays all the those great second leads and stuff and harmonies with me. Kerry Kelly, you know, he did the Alice Cooper 8 or 10 years and he did Slash for a few years and probably played with every LA band known to man in the '80s. He's kind of like that go-to guy to fill in for whoever needs, a great guitar player. So we grabbed him a while back and he's been great, great attitude. And that has a lot to do with, you know, fitting a night ranger. You've got to have a great attitude, positive attitude, be able to play great. And just, you know, I mean, when you're doing 80, 90 shows a year, you've got to have people in your band that are compatible, you know, you're compatible with. And, of course, we got our keyboard player, Eric Levy, has been with us, 12, 13 years. He's absolutely awesome. You know, he just plays everything perfect. And so, you know, it's the train moves on, man. But so we've been giving it still, you know, 100, 110% in every show. And we don't take this for granted, man. And we're just lucky to be able to be doing it this long and have a 40-year career.
I'm looking forward to seeing you guys and watching the show on September 3rd. Once again, if you're out of the area, I'm sorry, but you know, I'm going to plug it one more time because it's going to be a great show. Night Ranger, Sunday, September 3rd at the venue in Thunder Valley. And if you want tickets for that, they're at Ticketmaster.com or WorldOnePresents.com. Any message for all the Sacramento and Bay Area fans coming to see you play on September 3rd, Brad?
Yeah. You know, I got to tell you, this kind of a hometown gig for us too, because, you know, our roots started back in Mill Valley back in, you know, 79 when we, Jack Blaze and I morphed out of Rubicon into mm-hmm. Ranger. And then, you know, we did our demo and then I was able to replace the late great Randy Rhoads and went out with Ozzie for about 7-8 months and recorded the Speak of the Devil record. And then, you know, Rudy Sarzo, the bass player, quit to go with Quiet Riot, and I quit to go with Night Ranger. And here I am in the same band 40 years later. So, you know, our roots has been, you know, just great through the Bay Area. Got a lot of my friends and family and everybody coming up to the show, too. So we're all looking forward to that. And you know, just the Bay Area has always been great for us. You know, we've played everywhere, you know, and Thunder Valley, not too far. It's like only a little over an hour from the Bay Area. So, you know, that'll be a bunch of, it's kind of an eclectic bunch of bands on this one, Steve.
Yeah, it's like an 80s rewind festival that you guys are going to headline. Not only do you get to see Night Ranger, but extra bang for your buck, you'll see some of the big hits from Flock of Seagulls, Wang Chung, Everybody Wang Chung, Missing Persons, and bands like that, all on the same ticket. So it's pretty cool.
Yeah, pretty crazy. Like, we're the only big heavy rock band, so that's cool. But, yeah. You know, it's so funny because a lot of these bands I was fans of back in the day because I really wouldn't call a few of these bands one-hit wonders because a few of them had quite a few hits. In fact, the ones you mentioned had quite a few hits. But on the other side of the coin for me, you know, through the 80s, I kind of liked everything going on, all the radio bands who were doing well and on MTV and such. So it'll be fun not only to do this bill, but to see some of these other bands.
Other than the new album coming out, what's next for Brad? You got some other side projects happening?
Well, I've been trying to finish this solo record forever, but I keep writing new songs and getting different people involved. So hopefully that'll be out by the end of the year. I'll have something going to be able to release that. But, you know, I'm still doing my TV music and I've been doing that for over 20 years, a bunch of stuff for ESPN and Fox Sports. And, oh, I got a Flamenco tune on The Price is Right now. And, you know, just stuff like that. So that's my other little side gig. As long as it has to do with music, I'm doing it. And that's what I do at home when I'm not on the road. So I stay busy musically and look forward to our night rooms or shows. But I got to tell you, you know, everybody's healthy right now and has a positive mindset. And we're kicking butt. So we're looking forward to basically a hometown gig at Thunder Valley.
Hey, I look forward to seeing you. I know you're getting back on the road in another day or so, so I will let you go. And we will see you Sunday, September 3rd, at the venue at Thunder Valley in Lincoln, California. Brad Gillis, Night Ranger, you're going to rock the stage.
Thank you, Steve. Thanks for having me. And I'll see you here in a couple weeks, buddy.
Awesome. See you then. Brad Gillis, Night Ranger, you're going to be able to see him Sunday, September 3rd at the venue at Thunder Valley. That's in Lincoln, California. I will be there. I hope you will be too, on the bill with Night Ranger. What a show. It's the 80s Rewind. Night Ranger, Flock of Seagulls, Wang Chung, General Public, Wally Palmer of the Romantics, Missing Persons, Naked Eyes, Animotion, Shannon, Stacy Q. Wow. All that for the cost of one ticket. Once again, Night Ranger and the 80s Rewind 2023, Sunday, September 23rd at the venue at Thunder Valley. You want tickets? They're at Ticketmaster.com or at WorldOnePresents.com. The whole concert is produced by World One Presents. And if you want to follow their Instagram page for more details and updates on the entire show, just follow World One on Instagram by typing in at World One Presents. I'm Steve Garland. We are going to do some social media contesting for tickets to see Night Ranger. So please make sure and double back to our Hot Rock Podcast Facebook page and find out how you can enter to win tickets. So make sure and go to the Hot Rock Podcast Facebook page. Just type in Hot Rock Podcast on Facebook and you'll find it. And now, in honor of Night Ranger, we're going to rebroadcast an interview I did with Brad Gillis right at the time that their latest album was being released. A great hour with Brad of Night Ranger, and he's going to talk about his career, how he learned guitar, how Night Ranger was formed, and the story behind some of the hits. Very cool stuff. And that show starts now. Hey, rockers, welcome to a special edition of the Hot Rock Podcast. Night Ranger's first album in 4 years is out. It's called ATBPO, and the band played on Frontiers Music SRL. By the way, it is out now at nightranger.com. On the line to celebrate is my buddy and legendary guitar slinger trickster, Brad Gillis of Night Ranger. Hey, Brad.
Hey, Steve. How you doing, man? You know, We've had a long history together, man. What, 25 years? I don't know. It's been a while.
Yeah, I think it was 1982 when you guys first came up to the radio station, The Rocker in San Francisco, and Dawn Patrol had just come out.
So I guess it's been almost 40 years.
Oh, crap.
Wow.
Yeah. Plus all the crazy TV stuff that we did when I was doing the original Hot Rock TV series.
Yeah, so I remember that. Remember that well. Yeah, man. It's great to talk to you and get reacquainted and be on your show.
Awesome. Well, thanks, man. Let's jump right in because this new album, I got a pre-listen to. We're going to talk about it through the show, but it is absolutely on fire, dude.
Well, thanks. I mean, that's great hearing it from you. And the cool thing, Steve, is I've been hearing it from a lot of reviewers. You know, I did Germany and Sweden. And man, these people are saying, oh, this is the greatest record ever. If it was released in the 80s, you'd be as big as Def Leppard or Journey. You know, it's like, okay.
Hey,
I love all the analogies. You know, okay.
You can put me in that same stack. You know, it's the title of this, by the way, is And the Band Played On. So let's start with that. I have a clue, but where did that come from?
Well, you know, I mean, being in this COVID situation and being kind of stuck at home, late last year, everybody was getting a little antsy to do something. And And we knew we had another deal with Frontiers. They love having us, and we love being on their label. So, you know, basically, we just kind of decided, how are we going to write this record? We couldn't get together. No, you know, everybody lives in different areas around the country. No flights going on. This is around September of last year. We thought, well, let's just start out with some Zoom calls. So, you know, the nucleus of the band from the get-go, Jack, Blaze, Kelly, Katie, and I, got together on Zoom and just started going over the different ideas. I had riffs, I had melodies, Jack had lyrics and titles, and Kelly, you know, everybody had a little something. Did quite a few little Zoom calls, and just everybody had their either phone on record or a little tape player to record the ideas down, and we did like, I don't know, 17 or 18 tunes. And then once we kind of had those songs, rough ideas, we figured out, you know, the tempo and the arrangements. And when we had Kelly Cagey, who lives down in Phoenix, Arizona area, go into a big studio there and cut the drums. Once you got the drums, you know, then game on, you know. So everybody
exactly.
Everybody with their own home studios, we'd pass around the files and everybody would just interject their, you know, ideas and throw something down. And I'd get together with Carrie Kelly, the other guitar player. We'd come up with these harmonies and stuff on Zoom. And then we'd start laying them down. And Jack and Kelly get together for vocals. And it took longer than normal, Steve. You know, it was probably a 5-6 months to do this record, but we kind of had the luxury of time,
right?
Because things weren't opening up, and so you know, we were able to go in and just throw it to Anthony Fox, who mixes a lot of our records. Great guy, great mixer, and you know, just proving all the mixes and everything, and done deal. So the hardest part was after you finish a record, waiting that 3 months for it to get released. It's like,
right?
Oh, you want people to hear it, you know. So it's out. So, you know, it's fun. We're looking forward to playing a couple of these songs live.
Kudos to your producer and mixer, because the album is really crisp and clear. And Kelly's snare, I can hear him popping, and it sounds like the drums were mixed first, and now you're telling me they were, or at least his basic tracks were. It's just really right up front, and the rest of the band, it's mixed with the normal and lovable Night Ranger crunch with the guitars up and loud. Honestly, the quality of the LP itself, just sonically, is beautifully produced.
Well, thanks, man. You know, the thing with, you know, recording these days with all the latest, you know, in technology and stuff, you're able to really get music to hit you in the face, you know, and that's what we wanted to do. I've always been a drum guy. In fact, every record we did, I want to make sure that the drums are out front, because that's your beat, you know, that's the foundation. So Kelly went into this nice big studio and they kind of left the drums kind of open and airy. A lot of bands, what they're doing now, they're clamping the drums, putting a lot of compressors and stuff on the snares and kicks, which make it almost sound bigger, but it loses its natural feel. So we kind of went old school on that and just went into the more open, airy drums. And once you get that, man, I mean, it's, you could have the crappiest sounding record, but if your drums sound big, it kind of works.
I think we played some of those in the 80s where I scratched my head and said, so the music director likes this, huh?
Yeah.
You know,
well, so we're happy about it.
Awesome. So, you know, we know what the critics are already starting to say. You've heard me. How would you describe the sound of the new album? Because your fans are listening worldwide right now, including Japan, which I know loves you. We've had 267 requests for Breakout in the last 3 days.
Oh, well, there you go. You know, I got to tell you one thing. One reviewer said, you know, something like, it was a joke, but he said, Breakout, is that a song about acne? It's great, you know, just to know that, you know, people are digging the record, and, you know, the Breakout's on YouTube, and I think we're up to over 300,000 hits on it.
Set me straight. Is this an song that you wrote and brought to the band, or how did this come about?
Yeah, I'm writing tracks all the time, whether it's for TV music or the solo record I've been trying to get out for years, which I'm close to getting done, but I got a couple new guys that want to sing on the records. I can't really talk about it, but just trying to get that done. But I wrote that track and pretty much the whole arrangement. And the guys heard it and loved it. And so we basically had Kerry Kelly come in and add a rhythm guitar part, and we and him and I threw solos in, and Eric put some keyboards in and redid the drums with Kelly, and Jack did the vocals, and there you go. And you know, when we kind of did something a little different, we had Frontiers, and we asked for their opinion on what they thought the first single should be, and they all came back to Frontiers saying, oh, we think Breakout should be the first one. I'm thinking, and they said it sounds most like Night Ranger. Well, I wrote the track. Maybe that has something to do with it. And Jack's vocal, too. So I had no problem with that being the first release. Because there's a lot of fire to it. You know, it's got the Nucleus Night Ranger sound, which is, you know, twin guitars and solos and harmonies and, you know, the big vocals. And actually, on that song, you have more of a gang chorus on that Breakout and hey, you know, gang thing. But the, you know, the usual Night Ranger format is the 2-3 part harmonies on the choruses. But that one's a little different.
In about a month or two, once your biggest fans that buy all the tickets to the concerts buy the album, download it, and hear this, then they're going to be yelling for it before you guys even play it.
Well, you know, it's just great to always have something new. I mean, Jack says it at every show, you know, whenever we have a new record out, he says, you know, we're like sharks, you know, and you know, they got to keep swimming or else they die. You know, we're musicians, we got to keep creating or else our musically and we die, you know, on with the creativity aspect of being a musician. So to be able to constantly do records every couple of years, throw a song or two in the set and actually sell records, and us being together for 40 years, except for our little breakup of the 90s when we took a little hiatus from 89 to 95. Everybody was doing kind of different things back then. Jack was doing the Yankees. I was doing my solo record. I had Greg Allman singing a couple songs. And
yeah.
Everybody kind of doing their own thing. But so next year will be our 40 year anniversary tour.
Wow. Okay, I'll remember to send a card.
Yeah, but we just started putting that into the set. We played it, I think, 4 times so far in the last 4 shows we did, and it's coming across real well. And you can even tell sometimes you play shows and somebody are there to, you know, see the old hits but know nothing about a new record. So when we play Breakout, they're like, you know, you can see, you know, deer in the headlights kind of thing. And then once we get done with it, they're like, well, that was pretty good, you know? And so we've been getting a great response for it. So I'm pretty excited about that.
Get it right. I think you got too much at stake to lose.
It is Breakout from the new album ATBPO from Night Ranger, their first LP in 4 years, out on Frontiers Records right now. Frontiers Music SRL. Brad Gillis, lead guitar player extraordinaire with the band, is with me. With the time that we have, I want to just run through some of these tracks because I've listened to the whole album, and I want to just get some quick reactions here. Track number one is called Coming For You. It's a great opening track. You've got a chromatic guitar riff rock thing going on to my ears. Jack's vocals, by the way, across the board on the whole album are really strong. It's almost like, did he gain a couple of notes in his range? Because he's just rocking it.
You know, let me tell you one thing about Jack's voice is he's singing the best he's ever sang. One thing, I believe. And sometimes you write songs in a certain key, and you know the range of the singer, right?
Yep.
And when a singer hits those high notes that are at the top of their range, that's where you get that girth and that slight distortion and that angst that comes through on a recording.
Absolutely.
So Jack hit it home with Breakout and Coming For You, and he just hit it on those. But I don't know if the intention was to be heavier on this record, but it ended up being heavier.
Yeah.
You know, the song's choice and stuff. And, you know, us being all tied up in a COVID situation and us having a little more aggressive energy to throw into the record, whatever, whatever. Bottom line is, it's probably one of the hardest records we've ever done as far as song choice.
You guys are at maximum. You know what I mean? I'm hearing the coolest, wildest, most awesome guitar solos. I'm hearing the strongest vocals. And that's no BS. I mean, I think you guys really knocked it out of the park on this.
Well, thanks, Steve. You know, we had the luxury of time. And that was a beautiful thing.
And that's something you guys didn't have when Night Ranger was recording back in the 80s, right?
Back in the day, back in the 80s, of course, when we did our first record, we had already had those songs together and been playing them. And, you know, we were able to hone in a great record with the Dawn Patrol, you know, which went double, triple platinum. Who knows by now? But then when we went in to do our second record, we held Sister Christian back for our sophomore record because the record company knew it was going to be a huge hit. But then we went in and Jack and I wrote Rock, Still Rockin' America, and that turned out to be our biggest record to date.
Yep.
But going into the studio back then at, you know, $1,000 to $2,000 a day, back in the day, you know, since we did everything in our home studios during this COVID situation, we were able to take our time and do whatever we wanted. There was no hurry. And we didn't really see an end coming to COVID. You know, when we started this thing in September and ended up maybe March, April, whatever it was, then we started getting into mixing and such. But we just had the luxury of time with no incurred expenses because people did it at our home studios, except for Kelly going in and doing drums at a big studio, which he cut in 2 days. You know, that was the only big expense, and everything else is just like, hey, man, give me the files and I'll throw down a guitar solo. Also great, Steve, is, you know, writing guitar solos. You know me, I warm up and then I play something, but then I work late that night, you know, throwing down whatever, a couple ideas. But then to get up the next morning fresh and then listen back is a luxury that we were not used to in the 80s, because you go in and cut your solo, you know, of course you work on it before you know you're going to go in and do it. But we didn't have the luxury of really going in and re-recording anything the next day. It's like moving on to the next thing, moving on the next thing. And it still cost a couple $100,000 to do records back then.
We'll be right back.
Hey, just a reminder, this is the Hot Rock Podcast. You'll be able to hear this on demand anytime you want at hotrockpodcast.com, along with our streaming radio partners worldwide. My guest on the show is Brad Gillis, guitar slinger and one of the founding members of Night Ranger. I grew up like you did with Jimi Hendrix, and my first time I hitchhiked anywhere to see a show was in 1968 at 13, and it was to see Hendrix at the Fillmore. And
awesome.
Yeah. Dude. I mean, it was, wow. I was, you know, scared to death because I'd never hitchhiked before, but it was Hendrix. Why wouldn't you?
Sure.
Right?
I was going to say, he's my idol. He's a big influence on me because my brother, being 7 years older than me, 68, 69, he had all the greatest records in his collection. And, you know, everything, you got to realize all the big boys that came out then, the Doors, you know, Big Brother in the Holding Company with Janis Joplin.
Yeah.
And, you know, Jimi Hendrix, Santana, you know, all these great records. And my brother go out every night and I'd sit in his room and I'd learn by ear. I'd put on these records and try to, you know, figure out the chords, which got easier after a while than trying to learn lead guitar. That was a challenge. But, you know, I with persistence, that's landed me to where I'm at today.
Don't tell me you love me. Don't tell me.
If you're just joining us, this is the Hot Rock Podcast. I'm Steve Garland with my guest, Brad Gillis of Night Ranger. We're talking about the new album, the first in 4 years from Night Ranger, ATBPO. And if you miss any of this show, you can hear it on demand at hotrockpodcast.com for free. Now, Brad, let's also talk about your influences. You and I both grew up with Hendrix. And who else? Who else made you decide to play guitar?
That would be Jimi Hendrix and Jimmy Page from Led Zeppelin and Jeff Beck. You know, they all had these different aspects of their playing. You know, Jimi Hendrix with his flamboyancy and his style, you know, and Jimmy Page, not only a great player, but this melodic sense and his two-string chordal, arrangements on songs and just, you know, the structure of chording and his melody of guitar playing, just unbelievable. And then you got Jeff Beck, who's like the king of taste, you know?
Mm-hmm.
The whole phrase, less is more, you know, came from, people talking about Jeff Beck, you know? Another classic example is when we toured with Kiss, our first tour in 1983 after the Dawn Patrol release, Vinnie Vincent was in the band, and Vinny go up and do this guitar solo, all these notes and everything, and the crowd's like, whatever, right? Paul Stanley goes up and hits one note, and it's sustained, and he throws his hand up in the air, and the place goes absolutely nuts. You know what I mean? One note, you know? My thought has always been, recording records and doing guitar solos is, I try to play with melody, so when the solo's done, you could, you're done listening to that song, or you could get away from the music that you're humming that melody, because melody's king. And then, me being a whammy bar guy, Eddie Van Halen 78 came out with this whole dive bomb harmonic thing, and it was killer. And I thought, well, how can I be different? I'm the guy that, Eddie Van Halen got the first Floyd Rose ever made, Floyd made like 25 Floyd Roses in his garage before he started making them constructing them in a big location, then subbing out to Germany and Japan to make these Floyd Roses. But, out of those 25, I probably got a dozen of them. I got the third one ever built because Eddie got the first one, Neil Sean got the second one, and I heard that this music store in San Francisco back in the day called Don Weir's Music.
Yeah.
Had the third one.
That's where I bought my first bass amp from. When You're Ready, Don Weir.
Yep. And they had the third Floyd Rose, and I didn't have a lot of money in 78, 79, but I did have a white Les Paul Custom. Everybody thought it was crazy, but I traded that Les Paul Custom in for that third Floyd Rose ever built, which is still on my main red Strat, and it's case hardened steel. The thing is like, it's the king. It's a king of Floyd's, these original ones. Eddie was doing these dive bombs, and I just started, hit that whammy Floyd Rose and bringing harmonics up. And then I started banging on my guitar one day and I went, what the hell is that? I banged it again. And I figured out it was the Floyd Rose tremolo shaking. So you could hear it on my solo on Don't Tell Me Love Me. I do the flutter, then I do my big harmonic, whammy, the thing at the end. So just wanting to be different and stand out, the whammy bar and it's been my go-to and the crux of my style.
Over the years, that's one of the many things that has distinguished your style is not just the whammy bar, but the fast notes, the super long sustain, and most of all, melody in the way that you write your solos.
Yeah, that has always been part of my plan, to play solos with melody, less is more. And all the other guitar players I've had the, you know, luxury of playing with in my 40-year career with my arranger, everybody from Jeff Watson to, you know, even Red Beach was in our band for a tour. And then, of course, Joel Hoekstra for many years, just a fabulous yep. player. And now Kerry Kelly, another, you know, they're all four have been great players. But, you know, and they all kind of have that same style, that, you know, that that Shanker type, you know,
yeah.
the fast picking stuff. And you know, I don't even want to compete with that. I want to be me. And when you hear a dual solo, I want to have the difference in sound and styles that so when you hear a Night Ranger song, you know it's me playing, or you know it's, especially on this record, you know it's Kerry playing guitar. So then you always get together for the harmony solos, and you know, and you get their idea, a little bit of my idea, and you forge them together, and then you come up with that nice harmony solo. You'll never hear a Night Ranger record that doesn't have dual harmonies on it, because that's our formula. You know, the formula is that the twin guitars, two different styles, and the harmonies when we get together, and then Jack and Kelly, you know, a lot of it's those songs from back in the day and stuff. You'll notice that Jack sings verses and Kelly will sing the B section, and all three of us will come together on the chorus, you know, and that's been a kind of a staple for Night Ranger, but we've always kind of stuck to the formula. The only difference being is the production's bigger and better these days, and louder, and
yep.
and more in your face. And like I said before, the luxury of time to do this new record, we're able to really hone in on the best stuff.
So what do you think has kept your relationship with Jack and Kelly in particular so strong and still so creative after almost 40 years?
Not touring in a bus. That's one thing that nobody in this band misses, is going out on tour and touring for, even if it's a couple of weeks to a couple of months, like we did back in the 80s, you know, when we were all young and most of us were single and it was a free for all. You know, everybody now, you know, we do the weekend warrior thing. We go out and play on the weekends and we're home during the weekends. Like, okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
I'll see you in a couple days.
Little ibuprofen, please, for this row.
Yeah. You know, before we used to, you know, drink vodka. Now we're all taking Geritol.
Oh my God. Hey, listen, I've been with you guys right after the show, and everything mellows out after a while. You know, it was pretty wild in the 80s. People tell me we had a good time.
You know, it's like, you remember the 80s? It's like, yeah, well, I don't. Well, you must have had a good time.
Exactly.
Sister Christian, oh, the time has come, and you know that you're the only one to say, okay. Where you go and what you're looking for, you know those boys don't wanna play no more with you. It's true. Oh, motoring.
We got a couple of minutes left with our special guest, Brad Gillis of Night Ranger. Brad, I've known you over all these years, along with Jack and Kelly and the band. Love to see you live. So where are you playing next?
We're doing a Colorado show coming up. And then after that, we got Vegas coming up. And then we have the Summerfest in Milwaukee area, I'm pretty sure. Summerfest is huge. A bunch of other big shows, of course, the Kiss Cruise over Halloween, going to Japan, and hopefully we'll be doing everywhere in Japan. Like I said, I think we're doing 4 shows in Tokyo, which is awesome. Then we got a bunch of other stuff going on. I mean, and things keep coming in, Steve, so you never know. But when we go to Europe, we're trying to book, do Germany and England and Italy and Sweden and whatever, wherever we can to make a tour out of it. Last time we went to Europe, well, we went there a couple of years ago, but the last big tour we did was in 2011 with Journey and Foreigner. And that was awesome because it was big shows everywhere. And we had this old funky bus that we traveled in. It was kind of weird, but it was great because, you have a couple of days off here and there, you're able to see the sights. So it's always a blast going to Europe, but, hopefully this Delta variant won't shut things down and we'll keep this machine rolling and be able to come to any and everybody's town in the next, 6-8 months.
Awesome. And a reminder for those of you in countries around the world, you want to know where Night Ranger is playing, just go to nightranger.com and go to their tour dates listing. Brad, it's so much fun catching up with you, man. It's been a while, but you guys have always been, and I've said this publicly, what I believe to be in the top 3 finest bands of the 80s that still sound as good, if not better, today. And I mean that, man.
Thanks, man. I appreciate it. There's no rest for the wicked here. I mean, and you got that little firecracker named Jack Blades running the band, running around like a chicken with his head cut off. You're going to have a great show because the energy's there. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
And, we're all still throwing it down. It's exciting to have a new record. It's exciting to be touring and just doing what we love to do, And now it's the next pinnacle of our career with a new record and with some great shows coming up, and looking forward to that Kiss Cruise. That'll be a blast hanging with those guys again and all these other great shows we have going on. So, yeah, hey, thanks for having me, Steve. And hopefully, we'll get to a Sacramento show here real soon, something by you.
That would be awesome, man. The album, once again, is ATBPO, and the band played on Frontiers Music SRL. It's out now, available wherever you buy streaming music or CDs on the planet, including NightRanger.com. Hey, Brad, great to catch up with you, man. Give my best to Jack, Kelly, and the band, and hopefully we'll have a chance to talk and catch up soon.
You got it, my friend. And Steve, thanks for having me. It was great to catch up, and hopefully we'll run into you and we'll hang out at a show here soon.
Keep rocking,
man. All right,
man.
Buddy. Take care.
Once again, you can pick up the new album, Night Ranger, ATBPO, their first in 4 years, and from this reviewer, it's really some of their finest material they have ever done. It is right up there with your favorite Night Ranger songs. So much so that I got to play Breakout one more time. But if you want to get more information on the album, where Night Ranger's tour is landing next, including Japan, Europe, and the USA, go to NightRanger.com and take a look at their tour dates and the new album, ATBPO, on Frontiers Music SRL. I'm Steve Garland. Thanks for listening to the Hot Rock Podcast. We'll be back again with another great rock band and some of my old buddies that I've been hanging out with since the 80s, right here on the Hot Rock Podcast. Until next time, keep rocking.